When I was young, America did not treat men and women equally. This situation has improved, but we still have a long way to go to reach true gender equality. However, I was lucky. I was born into a family that gave me many educational opportunities. I attended excellent American public schools, and I developed a real love of learning, especially in math and science. However, in my advanced math and science classes, I was often the only girl. After my junior year in high school, I attended a National Science Foundation program in biochemistry. I loved it. We learned biochemistry. We learned the naming of compounds that is used in organic chemistry. We learned laboratory techniques, and we worked on teams to do original research. However, in this program, there were only about 200 boys and 11 girls. I believe my background in math and science played an enormous role in my getting into Yale College. I entered, Yale College took women in 1969, and I entered Yale in 1970 as a member of the second class of women to come in as freshmen. When I started Yale, the ratio of men to women was 7-1. And when I graduated from Yale, the ratio of men to women was 4-1. In my math and science classes, the ratio was even worse. Once again, I was often the only girl in class. Now, the situation has improved since then, I am happy to report. While in 1977, only 25% of STEM bachelor's degrees were awarded to women, by the year 2000, 40% of STEM bachelor degrees were awarded to women. However, a disproportionate number of those degrees are still in the biological sciences. There are still very few women in the physical sciences and engineering. In fact, the percentage of women in engineering has never exceeded 25%. Now, my good education has brought me a lifetime of benefits. It has qualified me for well-paying jobs. And women who don't have a good education often have to be completely dependent on their husbands because they cannot support themselves well. In addition, my education has enabled me to have a high-quality relationship with my husband. My husband is a pediatrician and a healthcare administrator, and we talk about our day every day. Sometimes we only talk for 10 minutes. Sometimes we talk for 2 hours. He benefits from my experience as a management consultant who helps companies and other organizations become more effective. And I benefit from in-depth exposure to healthcare, a field that is not my own. In addition, we share ideas about books we read and recommend books to each other and to our children. And we discuss social issues and generally support each other's development as human beings. My good education has also enabled me to oversee the education of my children. I have 2 children, and I was able to pass on my love of mathematics to both of my children. Consequently, they both studied mathematics up through the graduate school level. But most of all, my education has shaped the way I think. When I hear that a company has developed a new drug that will cure cancer, a whole bunch of questions pop into my head. First, I think, who funded this study? And could they have shaped the results of this study? Could they have had an influence? Secondly, who did this study and what were their credentials? And what population did they study and how big was the sample and what methods did they use to analyze the results? All of these questions are a result of my training in the scientific method. Now, when we think about educating children, society should have three major goals for educating children. First, we should try to create environments that help all children maximize their potential. Secondly, we want to help students see themselves as capable so they will choose to become lifelong learners. And finally, we want to create competent, active citizens who will make a contribution to society. So how do we do this? I believe we need to create environments that promote children's intellectual, emotional and social, spiritual, and physical development. So how do we educate children successfully in order to do this? The answer, I believe, is to focus on what I call the real ABCs. When you learn English, it's called learning your ABCs. But to me, the ABCs stand for attitude, basic and not so basic skills, and content. Now, many people, when they try to reform education, look first to reform content. I believe this is misguided because attitude is the most important product of children's formal education. It is the attitude that you take away from your education that will determine how you feel about getting educated for the rest of your life. Now, there's much research that shows that having a positive attitude makes it easier to learn. In fact, there's a saying in America, if you believe you can do something, or if you believe you can't do something, you're right. So many people who have had negative educational experiences themselves believe that the only way to persuade children to learn is for adults like their parents and teachers to force them. In contrast, the great psychologist Abraham Maslow believed that we are all born with what he called a drive towards competence. Now, babies who are trying to learn how to walk teach us a great deal about learning. While some babies learn to walk with astonishing rapidity, they go from crawling to walking, sometimes it seems like overnight. But most babies try and fail numerous times. They stand up, they fall down. They stand up again, they fall down. And yet, they learn to walk without teachers, without being told to sit and behave, and without adult assessment of their performance. They seem to learn for the sheer joy of learning. Now, anyone who has ever spoken to a three-year-old can tell you that all children have this joy of learning. But having this joy of learning by itself is not enough. The adults in children's lives also need to have high expectations for their performance. And the power of teacher expectations is demonstrated in this wonderful research study that is written about in a book called Pygmalion in the Classroom. So in this study, the researchers went to a group of teachers at a school and said to them, there's a special group of students in each of your classes who are due to have a great leap of academic achievement in the coming school year. Of course, the teachers got all excited. There's nothing more teachers want to hear than students will show a great improvement. So the teachers paid a lot of attention to those students. They made sure to answer all their questions. And lo and behold, when the researchers tested all the students in the school at the end of the school year, the students the researchers had identified had indeed had a tremendous leap in their academic achievement compared to the other students. But here's what makes this study so fascinating. The researchers had never tested the students before they made their prediction. The students were chosen randomly. The change in academic achievement was not a result of anything special about those particular students. It was totally due to the change in the teacher's behavior. Now, while attitude is the most important thing about educating children, it is skills that provide the foundation upon which education rests. And given the great leap in human knowledge that has taken place in the 21st century, perhaps the most important skill that students now need to acquire is learning how to learn. Lastly, we get to content. Now, clearly, content is extremely important. Basically, I want to talk about two kinds of content right now. There is the content that people acquire in order to become experts in a field. For example, people who get vocal training so they can become singers. And then there is the content that we all need to learn. It is shared content so we can participate in modern society. So next I'd like to address how society would change if we actually treated boys and girls equally. I'd like to talk about how the best American schools work to educate boys and girls equally. Now, in the best in American schools, the very best teachers, first of all, have the attitude that both boys and girls are capable of learning. And given what we just heard about teacher expectation, it makes sense. This allows them to have high expectations of both boys and girls. Secondly, teachers, when they are giving examples in class, use both men's and women's names, and they give positive examples of both men and women. And when they're giving examples, they include examples that run counter to gender stereotypes. So they talk about people like male nurses and female engineers. And they also encourage encourage classroom participation for both boys and girls. Now, the next thing I'd like to talk about is how women can learn to make good choices, so they can make decisions that are true to themselves, where they're not too heavily influenced by other people in their lives, especially the men in their lives. So the first thing about learning to make good decisions is to practice. Like anything else, if you practice, you get better at it. And part of practicing that parents should encourage is to ask children to make decisions while they are young. Small children can make small decisions like, do you want to wear the red shirt or the blue shirt? Or do you want peas or carrots for dinner? And decisions should become more challenging as the children develop, so that by the time they're adults, they're ready to make the more complex decisions that adults face. Secondly, we need to accept that failure is part of learning. We all fail sometimes. In fact, life does not come with an instruction manual. We learn by living. Someone once said to Thomas Edison, "You have tried 1,000 ways to invent the light bulb, and yet you still haven't figured it out. Don't you feel like a failure?" And Thomas Edison said, "Not at all. I know so much more than I did when I first started working on this. I have every confidence that I will figure this out." And lo and behold, he did figure it out, and he invented the light bulb and changed the course of human history. I noticed when I have trouble making decisions, I'm often trying to choose from very general options. So try to get more information and narrow your options. Secondly, separate what you can control from what you can't control, and try not to waste too much time on the things you can't control. Just make the best decision you can. And now I'd like to discuss an example that shows the impact that women can have. In 2010, I started Yale Women, which it was the first non-sports network for Yale Women alums. When I started this network, I had three goals for the organization. The first was that we would develop ourselves. The second was that we would create a strong community and support each other. And the third was that as some of the most educated and fortunate women in the world, we would work to better the world, especially for women and girls. Now, with all the billions and billions of people on Earth, it is truly amazing that there is no one else who is exactly like you. We all have something to contribute to the world. I believe we all have a spark of greatness within us. And your attitude plays an enormous influence on your life and the life of your children. So given that spark of greatness, teach your children to fan their flame. And I'd like to end with a quote from Nelson Mandela that has always inspired me. "It's not where you start, but how high you aim that matters."